Welcome. In this video, I want to talk about command line compression tools on macOS. And I installed these using the Macports system package manager. I have some other videos on Macports installing it and some other things. I'll put a link in the description to those. To get started, what I did is I needed some data to test. So I went in my mail directory under library mail on the system, and I have a Gmail account, and I pulled the directory from there and tarred it. And tarring kind of puts it into a container. So I have one file that's 291 megabytes here. And then I took that and ran it through this script that I made that tests all of these different compression algorithms. And I used the extreme settings on it, the highest compression, because I wanted the smallest files for this test. Then what I did is I let this run, and it is still running here, because this last one, this PAQ8P, is incredibly slow. So it's running right now. And what it does is it has the ability to actually compress the JPEG files. It has an algorithm or something to really shrink those down. But I ran this yesterday and it took hours. I lost track. It might have taken 8 hours to run, although this has been running longer than 8 hours, I think. This is still going. So I'll talk about this a little bit, but I'm not going to include it in my test. But so what I ended up with is this data here. I put it into a spreadsheet, and I have the PAQ8P on here. I'll just talk about this real quick. The size we start out with was 291 megabytes. And you'll see here the ranges in size I got were from 111 megabytes to 76 megabytes. And the PAQ8P was, I think, around 60. I think it was between 60 and 66 megabytes. I forget. And then as far as time goes, it just takes forever. So it's not very useful unless you needed to get something to the absolute smallest size. Like say you had a 16 megabyte flash drive and you need to just shrink a file down as small as you can to get it on there. That's a tool that you might use. But aside from that, I'm going to delete this from this list. So now we have everything else left, and I have a chart I made. I'll bring that up here. And this chart looks at these three columns here. We have the program I used, we have the time it took, and the percentage of compression, how much smaller it made it. So right now we're sorted by the percent. So this is the smallest or the highest performing as far as shrinking is at the top right now. And that was the XZ with the -9E. So that is the highest compression, and the E is extreme. So if you look here at the XZ, PIXZ and LZMA, these all use pretty much the same compression settings. Same with this 7-zip uses it too. And these, maybe even this 7-zip uses it. So when you look at these compression programs, they use some sort of algorithm on the back end. And I have a mix of these. Probably the most common one on here would be Zip. And then in the Linux world, gzip is very common. And if you want higher compression than gzip, a lot of times you go to bzip. And then like probably one of the least common on here would be this HA here and the lz4. These are not common at all. But I threw them on there just for the heck of it, just to try. The XZ and the PIXZ, this is a multi-threaded version of XZ. And XZ itself will do multi-threaded too. I should have put that on here, but I didn't get that run. And it might be the same performance as this PIXZ. And then the LZMA is similar to XZ. Now, XZ is probably the most common extension. You could say .XZ or .LZMA. So typically, you wouldn't use LZMA. You'd use this XZ. But the smallest file I did get was out of this XZ program. The largest was this LZ4 and the HA. And then gzip. So gzip didn't have the best compression on here. Let's see, then what else we have? This pigz is the multiprocessor version of the gz program. And then we have just your regular zip. And then this is a multiprocessor zip, lbzip. So this is a multiprocessor version of bzip. And so is this. So these three here are all bzip. And these are multiprocessor compatible ones, multi-threaded. So looking at this, if you want the smallest file, you want to use XZ or PIXZ, LZMA. You know, these are all about the same here to get the smallest. Next, I'll go in here and I will sort by time. So this is going to show the fastest and the slowest. So the slowest one was this HA compression. So this made a big file and it was really slow. So this would be awful to use. I don't know why anyone would want to use that. XZ is the second slowest. So this took a long time, but it made the smallest file. If you are archiving something, you might compress it with XZ because you're going to store it for a long time. You don't care how long it takes to compress. And I mean, then this did only takes, you know, a couple minutes to compress. Or if you're sending something online or making it downloadable, XZ would be a good option. And if you look here, the LZMA and the PIXZ were faster. So You know, if you want XZ, you'd probably want to use pixz or use the multi-threaded variant of XZ because it's a lot faster, still makes a smaller file. Now, the XZ had a slightly smaller file, but it wouldn't make enough difference that you would want to use XZ over pixz because it was very minimal in the size. I'll show that. Let me get back up there. If I can pull this down, if we look at these three, which are all essentially XZ, and look at the number of bytes, you know, XZ was 76 megabytes, the others were 77 megabytes, and you can see the number of bytes. There's very little difference here. So you'd likely want to just go with the fastest if you're going to use the XZ or the LZMA compression. So moving past these compressors, the LZMA ones, you'll look at the bzip ones. And the pbzip took, it looks like, about half the time. And then this lbzip was even a little bit slower. So if you're using bzip, you'll want to use this one here. This is the fastest of the bzip. And then you have the regular zips here. And then you have gzip. And they have this gzip and the pigz variant. This was interesting. So this was the fastest, this pigz, and the compression on it is not great, but it's pretty good. So if you have a lot of files that you want to compress, you might want to look at pigz because it's fast. Like if speed is an issue, if you have a large text file that you want to transfer over the internet and someone's waiting for it, this would be the one you want to use. PIGZ, compress it real quick. It makes it quite a bit smaller, and then you can send it over the internet, and then they can uncompress it. So other things to consider here are the use case. So if you are sending it to just a random person, using a regular zip is very compatible. All the systems work with it. If the person can download these other programs and, you know, something to decompress XZ, that might be something to consider. Like, you know, looking at something like HA, where it takes a long time and the file isn't very good, this would not be good for emailing someone. It's a terrible utility, and the person on the other end isn't likely to have a way to decompress that. Whereas with like zip, they would, or 7-zip, a lot of people are using that now. So I would say for, you know, the ultimate compression, you want to use XZ. If you want something that's compatible, use zip. If you want quick and pretty good, I would look at the PIGZ here. And this was on text mostly, because it was mail, and it had some JPEGs and some PNGs and maybe a couple docs in there. Although my email is not very heavy with those kind of things, but they were in there. So that's the kind of data. I don't know how these would perform on, say, audio files or video or photos. That could be, maybe I'll do another test on that. I don't know. So that's a comparison I did between these command line compression utilities. If you have any questions, leave them in the comments. If you want me to expand on anything, I could probably make another video. Place that down there too. If you have any questions about my methodology, certainly ask me. If you like this video, please click like. If you haven't subscribed my channel, I would appreciate it if you could do that. And thanks for watching. Until next time, goodbye.